Hello friends, a warm welcome to everyone. In this class, today we are going to discuss about data storage objects, which is one of the 6 info providers available in the system. Data storage object was formerly called as operational data store. So in this class, I will be helping you on how to upload a data from a flat file into a data storage object. And subsequently, I will also will be teaching about other few techniques which I can cover for DSO. Right. So this is the data that you see front. Is the data that we are about to load. It has 5 fields: employee ID, department ID, project ID, number of person, salary. So this is the data. So as you know, RSA1 is our first A course. So once you go into RSA1, this is the screen that you will get. So as soon as you go into the RSA1, enter into the info provider. So that info provider, other tab you can see on the left. Right click on the top and create your info area first. I'm going to name it as VDSO_IA, and I'm going to give the same in the description, and I'm continuing it. So, at the first step, you need to create your info area. Once you have created, you can come down and you can see that the info area is available. Now, go to the next tab called Info Object. The same info area that you have created should be available here. Okay. There are certain cases where it takes some time to get loaded. In those cases, you can just refresh the system. Here, I see we didn't get our info area here. So, on the top, you can refresh, just like what I did now. Now, if you come down and if you check, you can see the info area which is available. So, through this info area, we are going to make our further step. Now, all you need to do is right click on the info area and select the info object catalog. So, create the info object catalog. Where do we create the info object catalog? We are trying to create the template for this flat file. This file has 3 fields, of 5 fields, of which 3 are fields which are not subject to any change. There is the last 2 fields are subject to change. So I categorize the first 3 fields into characteristics, and last 2 fields I categorize them into features. So I'll be creating 2 separate templates, in which the first template will hold all the characteristic fields, which is 3. And the second template will hold all the key figures, and which is 2. I mean, the 3 fields, 3 characteristic fields are employee ID, department ID, and project ID, and 2 key figure fields are number of hours and salary. So, this is what we are going to do. So, now I will proceed to create my info object catalog with this info area that I created earlier. Right click, create info object catalog, provide the name as VDSO. I'm just using VDSO as a prefix for all the naming right through this process. IOC is for info object catalog. Here I mean it for characteristics. I'm trying to provide the same value in the description. And below, if you see in info object type, I'm proceeding with the selection of characters, because I'm creating this template for character fields only. I mean the fields which are not subject to any change. So it's always good to activate at the end of each step. So I'm proceeding to activate it. So once activated, I will get the catalog below. Now I proceed to the second one. Right click, create info object catalog. Provide the name as per your convenience. In this case, just be very careful while selecting the info object type. Watch it closely what info object type I select. Here, the info object type that I am going to select will be key figure, because they are subject to upgradation. I mean, they are subject to update. So, as I told you, activate it. So, now I have got both the templates on the left. Now, right click on the first template, create the info object. So, what do I need to create an info object? I'm going to feed the 3 fields into this template. I'm going to fill this template with 3 columns: employee ID, department ID, project ID. Right click, so really as well, my common prefix, and employee ID is the first column that I'm going to add. I'm trying to give the same in the description. And I'll continue once I provided the description. I will continue with my continue icon, which is a tick mark, green color tick mark. I continue. So once I continue, I will give you options for giving my data type and length. So also you can also maintain the short description here. So the data type I'm going to select it as character string, and length is going to be 5, and I'll activate it. The data type, whatever I select for all the fields, is just for simplicity. Make the process very simple so that it reaches to you. Now I'm going to select create my second info object, which is my department ID, I suppose. Yes, I'm going to give as a department ID. And the same in the long description, continue. Again, I'm going to select the same characteristic string as the data type. The length will again be 5. And I'll proceed to activate once I'm done with this process. And I'm waiting for my green signal. Yeah, I got it. I'll create the third info object type now, which is going to be my project ID. The same prefix. And by PID, I mean to say it's a project ID. And I'll provide the same data type, same length as 5. This is just for convenience, since this characteristic data type will suit all the three fields, I'm selecting all the same. Now, I'm going to create info object for my key figure template. Now, here, when I create an info object, you have to be very careful while assigning the data type. Provide the common prefix, number of hours, I'll provide the same in the description. Now, when I continue and see the data that's available data type, you will find entire different set of data types available for key figures. Because since I have given it to the key figure, my data types that are available here will be different based upon the key figure. So the number of hours is always an integer. So I am just selecting an integer and I am proceeding to activate it. And I am selecting integer because number of hours is what will maintain the sheet is an integer. And next I am going for creation of salary. Salary, the data type which I actually need to select is amount, but if you see in the available data types, I will show you, just provide the details and get it. In the available data types, you see there is an amount, but when you provide amount, you must provide a currency field for reference. So just to avoid those complexity or just to make this process very simple, I am going to continue by providing entity data type for salary also, so that our process is quite simple. So I provide integer data type for salary also, and I proceed to activate it. So once you have activated, we are good with two templates, and both the templates have their respective keys, and we are done with creation of info of the catalog. Right? Now going to the next step. In the next step, we are going to the resource systems tab. So in this tab, you have to create a flat file. You can either create from the top, right click and create, where you can select the flat file radio button, or you can directly open the file, right click and directly create a flat file. I would like to prefer the former method. Right click, create, go to the flat file radio button, continue. And this particular step, you have to provide the logical system name and source system name. I am trying to maintain the same values at both the systems and the border field. And be very careful, this particular step is quite a serious process. I mean, it's a time consuming step compared to all other steps. So be patient. It's basically based upon your system availability. So just be patient. So it takes some time to create your flat file. So taking some time to create your patience. I think we are getting closer. I think we have created it. So system has successfully created. Now if you go to the file, here it is. So this was the file that we have created. So what you need to do, you need to just double click on the flash file and see the movement of the cursor in the left side node. It will move from your source system to data source. All you need to do is just double click on the flash file that we have just created under source system. So once you double click, the system will automatically navigate to a different node, which will be data source. See, left side it has moved to data source and we have come to a different screen. So in this screen, now we have to proceed to create our application components. So right click and create your application components and provide the relevant naming. I mean, we are following a prefix of VBSO now. So provide AC, which will be abbreviated as application component. Provide the same in the description. So, yes. So we are trying to create an application component. So once we have created the application component, it should be available in the list here. It is at the last. So right click on the application component now and create your data source. So this data source is going to be the container where you are going to load the data from the flash file into the system. Right? So name it z_dso. So data source, yes, code, yes, it's going to be a transaction data. Remember that. So continue with it. So you will be creating a data source. Provide the short description, medium description, long description as per your wish. I would prefer to give the same values here. By loading data into the data source, you just mean that you are making the data available at the PSA level, personal staging area. Move to the next tab. Here the delta process is going to be a full upload, yes, direct process, I'm not allowing any DTPs. And in the adapter field, I'm just telling that the data is being loaded from a local workstation. Yes, it's been loaded from a local workstation. And in the file name, that's the field where we have to load our file. Now, proceed, search for the file, where is my info? Yeah, here it is. So the header was to be ignored, is the next field which I will be providing value as 1. Because in the file, we have the first row as the heading row, and I am allowing the system to ignore it because I have already prepared the template for them. So, in the form of catalog, you have seen it. And then, yeah, see here, this is the first row, EADBID, I'm going to ignore it, that's why, header row to be ignored. I'm just avoiding that. So coming to the next, the data format, yes, it's always the CSV file that we are going to load, so that's why I'm selecting the relevant data format. Data separator, I prefer comma as the data separator. I'll let you know where this comma comes into play. In exception, I always press a double quote. Now go to the proposal, click your load example data. You can just see the data here. You can see a comma there. This is separating each values of each row. So that's where I give a separator comma. So here you are just ensuring the check whatever you have done till here are good and we are good to go. If the data is getting loaded here in the example data, it means we are so far so good. So going to the next tab field, just check whether all the fields are maintained in the internal format. The format should always be internal. If it's external or some other format, just change it to internal. Since we have done all the steps till now rightly, and the format is being maintained right here. So once this preliminary checks are done, and you are convenient or comfortable with this step, you can go to the next step and read your previous data. The system will ask us to activate it. So here we are bringing the data to your data source. Now the actual SAP system has the data. From your flash file, your system has the data. Here is the data. So you have brought the data. Now you have to schedule the data to be moved into CSS. How do we do that? Right click, create your info package. Right click on the data source and create the info package. So this info package, from the data source that you create, will do the process of loading the data to the CSA table. So, right, you can create the info package. So, once we have created, provide the name. We are following the prefix of VDSO. So, IP will get updated as info package. And trying to create an info package, just have a check. You will get a green signal as yeah, check carried out, okay, and left at the bottom. So we are good till now. Now proceed for the extraction. Once you got the signal, you can proceed to the extraction tab. See whether all the values that we filled earlier are being maintained here. Just do the preliminary checks here. Yeah, it's a PSA load and it's a full upload. And schedule it in the schedule tab. You will be having an option for execute start. Yeah. So through this process, we are bringing data to the PSA table because no data in BI can escape from the PSA table. PSA table will be the initial slab where you can load the data. That is why it is very important to load data into your PHP table at first. For that, we are loading the data into the data rules and then bringing into the PHP table. So, we are done with the data load at PHP table level. Now, moving on. Once this is completed, go back to your info provider and go to the relevant info area that you have created, right click and create your data storage object. Here is where we are going to create our actual data storage object. Provide the relevant naming, whatever it is to. We are providing name, and I'm just trying to copy the name in the description field, and I'm creating it. So once the data storage object is created, now I'll go to the info object catalog, click on it, select the info object catalog, and I'm going to test out the relevant fields that I have created in the catalog and arrange those fields to the data storage object that I'm created, so that I'm preparing a particular template for the DSO. Now the template which I have created earlier is going to be helpful, and I'll again the same template to my DSO. Select the first template, info of the characteristics which will contain the characteristic fields, the fields which are not subject to any change. So click it, drag it and drop it in the field called key fields. Key fields are the fields that are not subject to any change. So individually drag all three fields and drop it into the key field. So I'm dropping my first field, now the second field, now I'll drop my third field. So all my characteristic key fields are dropped into key fields. Now I'm going to select the second catalog, and now I will drag and drop my key figures into data fields. So my data fields node or folder will hold my key figures. So once I'm done, I'll proceed to activate. Let it get activated. We are good so far, and we can proceed further. Let me give system some time for getting activated. So our DSO is getting activated. Hold on, still we didn't load any data. Yeah, our DSO has got activated. Now we have prepared our container with sufficient columns, with required columns to be more precise. Now moving on, right click on the DSO and create transformation. So through transformation, what we are going to do? Before that, select the relevant object type. Object type, yes, we are going to load data from the data source. So provide the data source as the object type and provide the data source name here. If you are not familiar with the data source name, whatever we have provided, you can just use S4 help. I'm just trying the S4 help so that you become familiar with it. And the source system will get filled automatically. Since we are taking from the S4 help, you need to name them individually, both data source and source system. So once you have created the transformation, Here we are trying to map the fields of the data source with the fields of the DSO that we have created. Right? So we have already loaded the data in the data source. So the data source will have certain five columns. Now I have created a template from the DSO. So I am going to map the fields from the data source. I am going to map it to my data storage object. So my employee ID, to my employee ID, just click on it and drag and end it at the right. Again, the second field, department ID. Click, drag, bring it to the right. 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 Yes. With this, my transformation is complete. So once my transformation is complete, you can just activate. And once you have activated it, you must get a green signal confirming that the transformation is successful. It is successful, and also you can see a pattern, a different folder here. Transformation activated successful. Now you can see a folder for data transfer process. This is the place. Create the data transfer process. Just have a check on these things and continue. So here is the place where actually the data is going to get loaded. In extraction tab, there is an extraction mode. Make it as a full update. I'll explain you what's full and delta. So extraction mode is going to be full data because I'm uploading the data from the data source at once. So all the data are being pushed at once, right? So this is the only thing that we need to do in this extraction tab. Now, once we are done with this extraction tab, we can move to our update tab. In this file, whatever values are here in this data, okay, all this data are being moved to my system at once. I have moved it to data source at once, and again from data source I am moving into DSO at once. The difference between full load and delta load is like full load is your initial load and delta load is the subsequent load being made. Right? I will cover also that. Now you can see the value here. It's 110, 100, 50, 5000 for the first row. So the same value I'm going to copy. The same value is going to be copied. Now go to the DSO. Our extraction tab is full now. I mean, my extraction mode is going to be full. So once your extraction tab, you are good with extraction tab, you can move to the update tab and get extraction here. Here it is, from PSA. You can see at the bottom, right? So go to the update, just provide the error handling. I always prefer the error handling method of 2. You can select anything, just in error handling way. I would always refer screen white error start update valid record. So you can provide any of the error handling methods as per your convenience or requirement. So I would like to prefer the second one. So just ignore this error. This is purely because of my configuration problem, my own system configuration. Just ignore it. So once you are done with the update, go to the execute button. You can see the execute button is disabled now. So you have to activate the system once. Now you will get an ignore the warning. You will get this execute button enabled. Click on it. Command the system to execute in background. So once it's executed, just follow the process, give it as yes. Yes, it's all green here. So with this, we can confirm that our data has been transferred properly into DSO. Now, how do we check it? That's again a tricky process. Now, in case of DSO, you will be having 3 bit tables. Okay? For that, first right click on the DSO and select the manage. Now, there is a request tab. In here, you can find the request ID. Go to the contents tab. 256 is the request ID. There is a request that was used. Go to the contents tab. In the contents tab, you can find 3 different buttons. New data, active data, and change log. Initially, whatever data you have loaded into a DSO, it will always be as new data. If you go to this active data and check the number of entries, it's going to be 0. Similarly, if you go to this change log and you see the number of entries, it's going to be 0. Which means that data is actually not as typically present in the DSO. Now, if you go to new data and check the number of entries, it will have 5 entries, which is the entries that we have loaded. You can also check the entries. You can see the entries being present there. Now, always the data whatever we have done will be there. Go to the request tab, click on activate, select the request tab which was used, and then click on the start button at the bottom. So once you click on start button, now this data would actually move from your new data table into your active data table. So this is where you are making the data physically present in the DSO. Keep on refreshing until this request tab vanishes from this menu. Because it means that it means that our data has been successfully moved from new data into our actual data. Yeah, it has gone. So now the data has been moved. Now close this particular window, and now again you can check the values on all the 3 tables. Now let's do it. So yeah. Go to the contents tab, now check the data as new data. Now here it's 0, right? Coming back, go to the actual data, click on here, now the entry should be 5. Bingo, we have got it, we have got all the 5 entries. Now if you want, you can check the entry. Now go back and check the entries in change log. Yes, you can check the entries in change log. Again 5 entries. Now you can check the number of entries also. So the change log will actually provide the updates that are being made. The reason for keeping the data and new data first and then moving to active data is like to avoid duplicate. The system internally does that. That's why it's being kept in the new data first. And when you load it into the active data, it will just avoid the duplicate entry. And if there is any updation, it will do that. Those things. Just to do these preliminary operations. So in DSO, we deal with 3 different tables. and now right click on the DSO and display data. If you go select all the fields for selection and select all the fields and execute, here are the entries. Now this is another way of checking whether data has been loaded successfully into DSO. You can also click the DSO and click on the display data flow. So if you can select upwards or downwards, whatever you wish. So once you click on the data flow, if you see, here it is. Data has been loaded from flat file into DS, which is the data source. And from data source, I'm taking the data into my DSO. So just to check the flow of data in your system, this is how you can do that check. Now, once the data has been loaded successfully, we can do all these checks, and we have cross-checked whether data has been loaded into DSO. It was loaded successfully, and so till now we have uploaded the data from a flat file and we have uploaded into a DSO. We will term this particular data load as full data upload because we have provided the entire transactional data from a sheet to a DSO, right? So with this, we have completed the process of uploading data from a flash file, which is a full data upload, into our DSO, which is data storage object, formerly called as operational data store. As I told you before, now I would like to differentiate between a full data upload and a full upload and a delta upload. Now in the Excel sheet, if you see, we have a transactional data for 5 employee IDs. We have uploaded the same data. Now consider the same employee comes again the next day and takes 10 more hours of transit and they are going to earn 1,000 more rupees of salary. In that case, I have to again update the DSO with my updated number of hours and salary, which is going to be a plus of 10 for number of hours and a plus of 1,000 for salary. So this update, what I am trying to do, the next time after the initial load will be my delta load. So the initial load, whatever I have due to the system through DSO, is going to be my initial full data upload, and the subsequent changes whatever I make to the particular DSO is going to be my delta load. Hope I was very clear with this particular point, because this particular point is going to be very important. That's the main difference actually with a full load and a delta load. I think you are clear till this point, right?